So the other thing about reading this story to get ready for it is, you know, we read these things and then it's just like it's a story about old people from a long time ago, and it's background, it's the backstory of us. So you read about that in the Apostle Paul's letters, that he's talking about Abraham, because you know, he's the first one God said, before that we had Jesus, before we had Moses, before we had any of that stuff, before there was a promised land, before there was a promise for the promised land, before any of that, Abraham. And so that's our backstory. It's like with you hear an actor get interviewed by Terry Gross, and they'll say, yeah, the backstory on my character is you know, what was this person's previous life before this movie? And you know, they have to make one up, you know, but it's what teaches, it's what helps them know, this is how I feel when I deliver this line and this dialogue. And it's what makes the character real in the film. God has a backstory. So Abraham's a backstory. So that's one way that these stories are important. But the other way is, Abraham is not just this guy from a long time ago that we know he's there, so, but you're us. There's always reading the story and saying, well, what if you're Abraham? What would that be? What would having faith in something that isn't already there yet be like? And how do you have courage to do what Abraham did? Leave his home on nothing more than a vision from God that says, take your whole family, go to a strange land where they don't know you, they might kill you, you might just die because you can't get along. Anything can happen, but go there because that's where I want you. And for no other reason be with you. What would that be like? Yes. So that's this, and then I like to look at the story that way also. Remember, these are stories that they sat around all day long. They're out working in fields and planting things and keeping sheep and the kind of cattle, all sorts of stuff they're doing. They just work all day long. But at night they sit around, they can't do any of that, they're quiet, they tell stories. And here they are, and like anybody else, they love those stories. Stories where strange, amazing things occur that really don't seem to happen in normal life, but yet they're true. Because you always start with those stories by saying, this is true. So this is true. And there's going to be a very scary, terrifying, ghostly part of the story toward the end. That if we don't get ourselves ready, like around, we'll miss the end. Those that happen. So be ready. So here's Abram and Sarai. She doesn't have her different name yet. And they're making their way to Canaan. And they've actually made their way there. They haven't even had, his first lady Hagar hasn't had Ishmael yet, so there's not that person. The only person he has to carry on his lineage is just this random slave that he owns. And this promise of lineage that follows him, there's not a single one. This conversation with the Lord occurs. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram, which is like a clue that says, this is very scary. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, you've given me no offspring. And so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, this man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. brought him outside. The Lord brings Abram outside tonight. He's having his visions. And said, look toward the heaven. Count the stars if you're able to count them. And then the Lord says to Abram, so shall your descendants be. And Abram believed the Lord. And the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. And then the Lord says to Abram, I am the Lord who brought you from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But Abram said, O Lord God, how do you know that I shall possess it? The Lord says to him, bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove and a young pigeon. This is a lot of stuff you have to be very wealthy with. Learn along the way that Abram does. He's very wealthy, even though he's in this strange land where he doesn't belong. And he's got the 3-year-old heifer, female goat, ram, a turtle dove, a pigeon. He brought them all these, he cut them in two, laying each half pound over the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. And the birds of prey came down on the carcasses. Abram drove away. So he's in this vision, and as the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram. So a deep sleep, it's like you go to sleep, but a deep sleep is this really kind of wild trance-like something that every now and then happens to somebody. And a deep and terrifying darkness descends on him. A deep, terrifying darkness descends on him. And then I just kind of went there at that for a while. And then finally the sun had gone down, and it was dark, and the smoking fire hot, and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. This is the spooky. Smoking the fire pot, flaming the torch, passing between the carcasses. On that day, the Lord made the covenant with Abraham, saying, your descendants I give this land, from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river of Euphrates. May God bless you with this reading from God's word. God's name be the glory and the praise. Amen. So what actually happened that you could, record, take a picture of, post a video on YouTube of? What actually happened? And what is sort of stuff that's legendary and mythic? And then the stuff that really happened, that's the stuff to pay attention to. And the other stuff is just made up stuff that, it has some sort of fairy tale point to it, but, it's just made up. And if we think of things that way, we'll never get it. We totally have to give up the notion that we got to decide what it could have been recorded on YouTube and what. Have YouTube, so they didn't have this problem. They're just talking about a wider reality. All is somehow the reality that people have in trances, and the reality of you hit a bell with a mallet and it makes a sound. All of that is just as real. And because you have dreams, and that's your reality. It's in your dream, but it's not. It doesn't matter. And the thing about dreams is that they matter a lot. You live by them, even though they're not there. Once you have it, it's gone. But the truth is, you live your life like this, though, because that's your life being now inside of you. This is what's happening. So all right. So there are these people that have made things the way they are. And we inherited and things have become fixtures in our mind. Like Frank Sear, you probably don't even know who he spelled, C-Y-R, you can look it up. Frank Sear, in the 1930s, he said, you know, we've got this public education now, we've got these contractions that people write around them, we're picking up our kids in these contractions, are they safe? We better make them safe. It goes around the country, we meet with all sorts of educators and planners and builders of buses. And then they all get together in 1931. Frank Sear, a professor of the Teachers College, Columbia University, probably had a success of humor like other people, graduated from Columbia University. Josh. And in 1939, they all sit down and they say, well, the axles are going to be made like this. There's going to be this kind of space and this kind of seating. And here's how the steering wheel would be. And they made a cover for the booklet. They put all that stuff. And the color of the booklet was yellow because the color of school buses was going to be yellow. And they are still all yellow. We just can't stop it. They could be pink, they could be blue, but they're all yellow for no other reason. But that's what they decided then. So that's what it's like to be Abraham, you see. I mean, he looked up and counted the stars. We have more buses, I know we do, than there are stars in the sky. And they're all like that. You go drive around during the day, 9 months out of the year, in the village, you'll see. So that's the way Abraham is Abraham. But so you know, we look back because we have things in life that are wrong. I mean, how we make our vows, you know, how we order dinner, all that stuff happens the way it happens here in a different way, someplace else. But this is the way we do it here because of somebody a long time ago. But then we can be Abraham. What if we're Abraham? God says, you've got something that I want, and it's a gift from me that I want for my purpose. And Abraham, that thing you've got to go take it and do something, go some place and live in some way that you would never choose and that scares you to death. But that's what I want. And you may not think we can have it. Abraham says, I keep not having children. I'm really, really old. But God says, well, let's see. I'm God, you're Abraham. But one of those things matters. Oh, that's me. So do what I want with the gift I am promising. And do what I want before you get the gift. And go to this place, and don't know what's going to happen, and don't know how it's going to turn out, and know that lots of people depend on it, and that you have no argument except what's inside of you, what's in your head, in your heart, what you found out. There's a gift in you. I have a need for you. which is growth. So one possibility is that's God speaking to you. The other possibility is you're having this grandiose delusion. And how do you know? Because the one is at least as likely as the other. And in fact, of all the people in the world that have had big ideas that they were going to go be rock star, or write a great American novel, or transform life in the country, the village, the world, wherever. I mean, there's one Mahatma Gandhi, and there's a lot of Indian novelists, right? Lots. Which, how do you know it's not your grandiosity? And it's hard. Because when you go through something risky, and not just risky because this is going to cost me a lot, but risky because it's going to cost you everything, you really want to know. Is it God or your grandiosity? So hard to say. I mean, there's no proof, there's no recipe for this. One thing we know from Abraham is, why did good of humility? Okay, I'll go. That's a lot of humility. I think I know better. In fact, my plan has been, I'll stay here. Things are great. That's a good plan. Everybody Abraham knows agrees with that plan. They like that plan. None of them like plan about going to this other place because God. So that's his plan. But he's humble enough to say, I'm going to try this. Because I think God asks. And the other thing he does is he goes and does it. And every step along the way, he doesn't keep saying, don't worry everybody, I'm going to have children. God says so. I've turned it over to God. I've turned it over to Jesus. It's all going to be okay. And all along the way, he does two things. He says, I am still not having kids, and I am so worried. And he also says, and I'm going to keep going. That's humility on both sides. I'm going to do what I think God says, humility. And I don't know if I'm right, humility. Humility is for sure a mark. A mark, not truth. A mark. Everyday faith. So I don't know. Now, I mean, the example I love using is music because there are people who can make music. So as playing bells. Two notes in one whole song, I'll get it, most of it. And I know that's making music, but it's the distinction I make between I make music and Larry and Sarah are musicians. Yeah. Something happens with them that hasn't happened yet. It may never happen. They have a gift. And God is saying, God may be saying that at any time, I want you to take your gift and go out and take a risk of it and do something for me. And at least what I know about those three is they've got an Abraham attitude. It's almost like I got my bag. Go ahead and do it. Is that presumptuous? No. I am the voice of God speaking to you. Sing all you can. Play all you can. Ring all you can. Conduct all you can. The more, the better. So that's that. And to do that takes a lot of work. Because I don't know if you've got any attendants who can try to do what they do, which is to be singing to you. How am I going to do that? I don't have any. I don't want to. Okay, I'll do it. That's what it's like. You've got something. And maybe you know about it. And maybe you don't. And maybe you're delusional. But maybe you're inspired. And at some point, when you read this story about Abraham, either today or tomorrow, I wish you to find out, is it my turn? Do I go? And I pray that you see it, feel it, choose it. Because then amazing things will happen. The amazing